Morning. Welcome. Welcome to our Sabbath School this morning here at the Bremerton Seventh-day Adventist Church. I'm John Kralinski, and Chuck, good morning.
Good morning. My name is Chuck Jones, and we are starting a new quarter this quarter.
What are we studying?
We are studying the promise, which is the promise, God's everlasting covenant. But before we do that,
you like to bring up the names of God. So what do we have today?
So this name of God is sort of an interesting name because it's shown throughout the Bible, but it is not an actual name of God until the New Testament. And that's in the first time it's used is in Mark 10:17 in the story of the rich young ruler, where the rich young ruler addresses Jesus as good teacher. It's not used before that. I checked again this morning. It's not there.
No, it's not. You're correct.
So, and actually, it's not used that much even then. It's used like once or twice.
It's how he perceived Jesus. It's actually his title for Jesus.
Yeah. So today we're going to think about this name, teacher. And to do this, as we have done so many times, we can go right back to the creation story. We're going to spend a lot of time in creation today. Mm-hmm. And in Genesis 1, we see the teacher in Genesis 1, 28 and 29 showing Adam and Eve the creation that he has made for them, teaching them about family, to be fruitful and multiply, to about being a ruler, and about what was and was not supposed to be eaten. Mm-hmm. And if we look at Genesis 2, 18 to 20, which is the creation story retold as a narrative, versus this is what happened, we see the teacher is showing Adam why he needed a helpmeet and how he was not complete without Eve.
You know, it's interesting that God as a teacher, not only is a teacher a conviction, but they're a mentor of method.
Yeah.
And you know, a guide. It's a broad, not just a pure, strict didactic. It's a relational reality.
No, you can be that simple, but it's much more expansive. A good teacher is much more expansive.
Yep. Yeah.
Oh, and so next we see the teacher in Genesis 4, and in Genesis 4, he works with Cain, trying to teach him how to control his anger
but
his rage.
Was he a good teacher? Did Cain control his anger and rage?
You know, if that is true.
Just saying, he has the term good teacher, but here it doesn't sound like it turned out good. I hate to throw a red herring into your morning, but
No. Sometimes the student does not want to be taught.
Ah. Teaching is a relational reality where there's two sides again.
Yeah.
There's two sides to the equation. It's not that God wasn't effective with Cain. It's that Cain resisted to take to heart
what he
was being told and taught.
Yes.
And for whatever reason.
Oh, and then we can go to Exodus 4 and look at the teacher. And this time the teacher actually sort of calls himself the teacher because he's working with Moses. He teaches Moses about his power, about his love for Israel.
Hey, how long was that apprenticeship for Moses under the tutelage of God?
Well, if you just take it from the time that he left Egypt, 40 years.
Yep, that's quite an apprenticeship.
Yes, and I would say that he was probably being apprenticed before that as well.
Yeah, he just didn't. He learned some stuff that later got applied, but it was the stuff he learned.
It was the stuff he learned in the desert that taught him to control his anger and rage.
Yeah, how to care for sheep taught him how not to beat up on people.
Yes, yes. But the teacher, God says, I want you to go and say this. And Moses tells God, I think you've got the wrong guy.
Yeah.
I don't know how to do that stuff. And the teacher says, don't worry, I will teach you what to say. I will teach you how to say it.
And I'll even give you a mouthpiece to say it through.
Since you refuse to do it.
Yeah, because you still refused. Your brother Aaron will work for you.
Oh, and then we can go back to the New Testament to see the good teacher at work amongst the people. Jesus was constantly teaching.
Yep.
Whether it was with the multitudes, as on the Sermon on the Mount, or with his disciples, teaching them about his impending death.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus always seemed to be teaching. Mm. He would use parables, stories from the everyday life, to teach the people about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, the beauty of God's law, and that God loved them and was coming to set them free, no matter how marginalized they were here on earth. They were not marginalized with God.
Nope.
And in fact, it should not be surprising that in almost every story in the Bible, we see the teacher working. Sometimes right out front where we can see him, and sometimes he's in the background coaxing us on where to find him.
Mm-hmm.
I have had that experience recently. I just read the story, and I'm going to forget the guy's name, but the guy that sacrificed his daughter.
Oh, Jephthah.
Jephthah.
Numbers, yes. Judges 11.
God is coaxing there because he's not right out front. That was there's something to learn about God in that story.
That was the Easter sermon in 2014? Anyway, connect those dots.
And this should make sense, really, because the Bible is God teaching us about him, teaching us to restore the relationship that we broke.
Yeah. And then he tells us the necessities that we need to know to trust again.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So praise God that he is our teacher. And I think I will lead us
sure.
off in prayer this morning.
Please do.
Heavenly Father, I thank you and I praise you that you are our teacher, that in everything you give us, in what you have created, in your word, in our interaction with people, in marriage and family, you are seeking to teach us. To teach us and to lead us to be with you, to restore our relationship with you. Father, I pray now that as we begin the study on covenants, that you would open your word to us and that we would learn to trust you and love you more. In your name, amen.
Okay. Amen. So now we are in this idea of covenants, and I suppose we should define it.
Well, we can't do that yet because we haven't done the focus text.
All right, what's the remember?
We have to do the
Thank
focus
you.
Text first because... You know me, I am checklist oriented. I have to do things in order.
Oh, okay.
So, Genesis 1:26 and 27 is the focus text this week. It says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God he created them. Male and female, he created them. So now... We are starting this new one, and it's interesting that we start a lesson on covenants in a story that doesn't say anything about covenants, and the lesson said nothing about covenants.
Well, it did in an indirect way, and I'll tie it in because you actually read the covenant passage of the creation story, but it's an implied passage. And how do we know that? How do we know that we could actually say that there's technically a covenant passage here? You need to actually go to where covenant is used, and that is used in the story when it first is used is actually in Genesis 6, but you want to go to Genesis 9, where the first covenant, where the term is used, is made in verses 1 to 3. God's making a covenant with Noah, and he says to them in chapter 9, words that will sound just like what you read, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth." But now there's some differences. "The fear of you and the terror of you will be on every beast of the earth and on every bird of the sky and everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea, and into your hands they are given." So we still have again the birds and the beasts and the fish, just like we did in the memory verse of chapter 1, only this time instead of peaceful dominion, there is now this new element of fear because there's this new element of sin. And then it goes on to say, "Every moving thing that is alive shall be food for you, and I will give it to you all as I gave you the green plant." Now, before, the green plants were sufficient for everybody, but now because of the flood, for a short time, there will be a need to have supplemental dietary restrictions and dietary allowances. And in this case, that's why God had Noah and his family takes 7 clean versus the 2 unclean into the ark.
Yeah.
And so that's the differences, but the word covenant there.
Yeah, because now we're at the point where we can ask, what just basically, because we don't want to cover too much of what we've got coming up the rest of the quarter, but basically, what is a covenant?
Yeah, a covenant is basically promise. The ultimate root of it all is promises between two people, where they agree on something and they promise, you know, cross my heart, hope to die, you know, whatever. Only often it's very one-sided. In the cases of covenants with God, God is the one-sidedness of it all, and our role is more often to say yes or no and to enter into that relationship. But it's promises for relationships.
Promises for relationships.
It's sort of like when you were saying earlier, God's a teacher. It's the covenants are how God is choosing to teach how to live and restore love in relationships. That's
okay.
A very simple way of saying it. And it's God's promise to be in a love relationship with you.
And I also saw, as I was looking up what covenants were, that a covenant, it's an agreement, like you were saying, a promise, and included in that promise are terms of the agreement as far as if you keep your promise.
Guarantees.
These are what's going to happen. If you don't keep your promise, this is what's going to happen.
Yeah, stipulations.
Yeah.
Yeah, the stipulations of the covenant are for, you know, if you do these things, this will be the result, and if you do these things, this will be the result. It's not so much saying, I'm going to do this. It's this just pointing to the results of what will happen.
All right. So the lesson started off this week by identifying, it sort of threw me off as we started off this lesson this week. Yes.
Well, one reason why you don't see the word covenant in Genesis 1.
Okay.
One reason why you don't see the covenant in Genesis 1 is because the humanity was in explicit relationship, explicit trust in God. Sin had not yet entered. They did not need a covenant. Much like when you're in love, you don't need to go down and rehearse your wedding vows every morning when you wake up. It might be a good thing to do, but you don't have to do that. You don't think in those terms. You're in love.
And I've been thinking about what you said, because we talked about this a little bit before the lesson, before we started. And when I met Lola,
yeah,
and I talked to her for a little bit, there was no other person that I wanted to be around. It wasn't like she had to say, okay, if we're going to keep going out, you got to stop going out with other girls.
There's no more seventh.
There was, no, and she didn't have to say that. It just, yeah, it happened.
It just
and
happened.
I think it happened with her. I don't know. I'd have to ask her. She's, I don't know.
Does she watch you in the morning online?
I think she is. I think she's watching with her mom this morning. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. So he's got a question. Sorry.
That's all right. So the lesson started off this week by identifying some basic questions that humans have, mm-hmm, about our existence. So they are, what is the world? Why are we here? How did we get here? Where are we going?
Mm.
And I was thinking about this, and we hear these questions quite often, though not necessarily phrased in the same way they were phrased in the lesson. We hear questions, for example, what is my calling? Is there more to life than eating, drinking, living, and dying? What is the point of life anyways? These are the same questions phrased in different ways.
Mm.
So the answers to these questions have not only permanent spiritual significance, but we are also finding that these questions have very immediate physical and mental health significance as well.
Let's back up for a second. Who
sure
is the audience? Who is the original audience of this book? Who wrote the book? Who wrote Genesis?
It was written by Moses, we think.
Moses, we say Moses wrote Genesis. Who is he writing Genesis for?
The Israelites, for the chosen people who are coming out of
Egypt. They're coming out of slavery. So he's introducing them to God. He is introducing them more fully to the God of relationship. And amongst the Israelites are also the mixed multitude. And so he is getting them all on the same spiritual page. There, you know, Israel is God's bride who he brings up out of Egypt in a certain way. You know, you can look at it in that way. So, you know, when you have that kind, they have questions of why, who, what, you know, and this is, you know, learning how to know where you're coming from and where you're going, you know. So it's an interesting, it's a way to approach it, is to say, who's he writing to and why? And
yeah,
do they need this information? Yes. Do we need this information? Yes. Continue.
Okay.
back on the list.
So, no, that's all right. So the lesson gave a few different passages to go to, but we're going to focus just in Genesis 1, and I thought we would cover these questions really quickly, just looking at Genesis 1. So what is the world?
Yeah. What is the world? You want to look at? Are we looking at verse 2, or are we looking at farther down the list there, that which is filled, or that which, you know, that which is formed or filled? Is there something there, or is there not? And there are basically about three or four schools of thought, because there is a hint there that you have at least some sort of substance and water. Because the Spirit is hovering over the face of the deep, and the deep was considered water. And so you have possibly already things there, and now God is going to do something with this unformed and unfilled stuff. And he's going to create atmosphere, he's going to create the planet that we know as Earth.
So at the very least, the world is God's creation.
The world is God's creation. He is the author of existence. I spent literally this whole last 2 weeks editing my friend Stan's Evolution Creation series that we used to do together and that he does a lot of. Really good, but my brain's stuffed with this, so be careful.
I'll try not to get too far off track.
I can easily run.
Why are we here?
Why? Because God, the very character of God is love, and love, you can't love alone in a closet. God loves people. God loves the beings he made to have community with, because love involves people.
And God intended us to rule the earth that he was creating.
Yeah, that's one of the things he gave us to do. You know, he's making this world and he wants us there. There's lots of things going on actually that are hinted in this story that aren't, that, you know, when you have to, sooner or later, the Hebrews that came out of Egypt would say, why? Why were they this way towards us? Why did they beat us and whip us and try to kill us and cruel to us? Well, you're saying God's love and God's compassion and God's all these things. Well, then why is there evil? And so that's another wrestling that happens in the first three chapters of Genesis, and possibly even hinted at when darkness is over the face of the deep.
Yeah.
That's you have the intimation, and the rest of Scripture brings it out, that there's already another entity present on earth in the beginning, and he doesn't need an introduction. He's called the serpent in chapter 3, but it's as if he's called the serpent. Everybody knows what Moses was talking about.
I don't want to get too far ahead, but we'll talk. There's some more language that makes us think that...
We're going to get to that in a little bit, yeah.
I'm pretty excited about that, too. So how did we get here?
Yeah, God spoke us into existence as far as the forming and filling of the world around us that we know, our environment. But then, as when it comes to humans, when the we is referring to humanity or humankind, then we are looking at it a little differently. God doesn't quite just go people, and there's people. He declares it, and he declares what he's going to make in chapter 1 and talks about their job description. But in chapter 2, the narrative form, instead of the declarative account, now we have the narrative story. God's doing something.
Yeah.
What's he doing is the question. What does he do in chapter 2? That's where your notes go.
We are going to get there. So the last one, the last question, which you're sort of alluding to, where are we going?
Ah.
And that's the only one that as I read through Genesis 1, and if we focus on these questions, just looking at Genesis 1, that's the only question that's not really
answered
in Genesis 1. It's sort of hinted at, actually it's not even really hinted at, because we don't even have the fall yet.
It is hinted at. It is hinted at, if we look at it correctly, it's hinted at in the word dominion. It is hinted at that this is your job, is to be in charge of this place I made over everything that I made. So they have been given their job description in chapter 1, and now they go out and will implement it, and God will teach them how. And I think that's why they will do that, and he will explain to them, and he will... But it's not just a dryless God job description, because God enters into the process. He's involved with them. He's active in relationship with them. So we can't ever lose that relational element, or we can get distracted easily.
So the next thing, the lesson pointed out something that I found was pretty interesting. And how does the writer of Genesis present the origin of the heavens and the earth? Is it an opinion? Is it a...
It's declared. It's declared that God did it. The word bara, God created. It's the word that applies only to him.
Yeah.
You know,
it's a statement of fact.
Statement of fact.
You either believe it or you don't.
Yeah, you can't. I can't prove God did it because I wasn't there and don't have the video or the audio or anything. And nor can science prove the Big Bang because none of them were there. They don't have the video or the audio. All they're doing is looking way downstream and thinking maybe it happened this way. We got a comment coming from the orange mic. Orange mic. Here we go.
If you could just remember that Adam lived more than 900 years, and he could have repeated the story over and over and over to many, many generations, and those generations can tell their children, this is what we heard from Father Adam. And so the story could not have been so realistic and so true because it came from the mouth of the very one that was there in the beginning.
And it's the only... It came from the mouth of Adam. It's the only one that answers all the questions. The Big Bang,
yeah,
as they try to answer it scientifically, it doesn't work.
And it doesn't work to the point of even science in the sense that they see a lot of age and time, yet they can't explain how the process of age and time, which involves this thing called entropy, can be creative when it's always a loss of information, a loss of something. How can that make something more and better when you don't have less and less? We have a hand up, though, but
we'll go with the hand first.
Okay. Did God, when he created Adam and Eve?
There's no mic.
That's right.
Go ahead.
Were they supposed to live forever?
She asked, when God created Adam and Eve, were they supposed to live forever?
Of course. No. Yes. Yes. Eternal relationship. Ah, she's going ahead in the lesson and bringing up a text, but I'm going to stand by my thing that God intended for them to live forever.
I will agree with Pastor because...
Let her have her perspective.
Yeah.
I don't think they were supposed to live forever because... They weren't supposed to live forever.
Yeah, okay. Let me state this for your, I'll try to see if this resonates with what you're thinking or feeling about this. Because God put this tree in the garden, that
yes.
means that they weren't supposed to live forever, or else they wouldn't have had that tree there in the first place.
Exactly.
Okay.
They had a choice.
You have to explain the tree.
Ooh.
Go ahead.
You just said something important, something about
yes,
choice.
They had a choice that if they eat from the tree, they will die.
Correct.
But if they don't eat from the tree...
What happens if they don't eat from the tree?
What happens if they don't eat from the tree? You asked me a question earlier. Do I think God intended them to live forever?
They will live forever.
They will live forever. Okay. Scoreboard. Do a little scoreboard dance here. No.
All right, Greg.
No, you point out something profound. When you only work with chapter 2, verse 17,
yeah,
which is the verse you're quoting, you can easily arrive. And by the way, scholars like the classic German scholar Gunkel, early 1900s, he thought the same thing, and he thought that kind of stuff. Anyway, Brad, you were going to say something.
I have a question, too. And she has another one after mine. I'm sorry. So you talked about Adam and Eve were here, put to have dominion over everything, right?
Yep.
Did Adam and Eve, were they bound to the earth? Do you think they were bound to the earth
yeah.
forever?
Like I think they were earth created for this earth. You know what? Let's have some hairy reasoning and hypotheticals here. What does chapter 2, verse 16 say that also was said in chapter 1 when it talks about God making animals and God making people?
2:16?
2:16 or 5:22. I mean 1:22 or 2:20. Yeah, 1:22 or 2:16.
Okay, 2:16 says, "And the Lord commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden."
You're free to treat from how many?
Any.
Any tree. Is God stingy?
No.
Is God really trying to make their lives miserable and tell them that there's not a lot of stuff out here? Let's go back to what God did in chapter 122 to other creatures. He said, God blessed them and said, Be fruitful and multiply. Now, if you go to other verses, it also talks about God made man in his image, and then God blessed them and said in verse 28, be fruitful
and multiply.
Let's take this on. So they're fruitful and they're multiplying, and they're fruitful and multiplying, and there is no death because there is no sin yet. Let's say they don't eat from the tree. Yes, say they learned the lesson, and they didn't eat. Just hypothetically, exponentially, it won't take that long for the world to be full. One of two things will happen. Either A, God has a unique purpose for the full world that is now full of people that he made in his image, or God, the creator, perhaps is going to now make a new world and populate new places with people. It could go either way. Depends how you want to read the whole story. But there is a possibility. Those are just possibilities, hairy reasonings, my son calls. You know, just kind of, I'm not going to prove that. I suspect God had a purpose and a plan involved in part of it, but the main part is relationship, because God's a being of relationship. His ultimate characteristic isn't his sovereignty, which we focus on a lot, very Calvinistic, unfortunately. It is his love, which even lets him lay down his right to be right for the sake of relationship.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. The other question is, when the Bible says, God said, let there be, but then it says his spirit hover over the deep.
Yep.
That means something was there before he said, let there be.
And that's what we suggested earlier. Yes, I agree. Something was there beforehand, before he made. So what did he actually make? And the question comes in, does that mean there's long ages and stuff like that? I mean, no, probably not. You can go two ways.
Did he make water before he said, let there be?
There could have been in God's... See, it says in... Okay, Janet, you're going to take me back to my week of training. But real quick, we'll do it quick. Verse 16 of chapter 1, God made the two great lights, the greater light to govern the day, the less light to govern the night. Then comes a Hebrew parenthetical phrase. He made the stars also. He didn't make them on the fourth day. He's just letting you know that, oh, by the way, I made all the stars. He assigned the sun and the moon their task on that day, but he didn't necessarily make them all. So there could have been pre-existent universe or reality out there that he had already made at a prior time. We don't know how old that is or when that was. But he was still the author of all things that are made. There's nothing that exists without his provision and his voice speaking it into existence. That is what Genesis allows us to understand, which makes, I think, the most sense of the data that we have.
Right, and we know that God had made angels beforehand, so we were not the first thing that he made.
We also know, like we said before, that there's darkness, and there is an evil one that all of a sudden, where does he come from?
Yeah.
On Genesis 3, he existed before he was fallen. We can go into the story, but the text indicates in other parts of the Bible. You had more to say.
So is he still created?
No. We don't know. Maybe, maybe not. We don't know. I can't answer that definitively because the scriptures from this, I want to say stick with just the scriptures. The scriptures do not tell us whether he is still creating now or not. He is the creator. If anything is being created, then yes. If anything, if he put a pause on it, I don't know.
It seems like it's part of his character. It would seem like hard to stop. Now we're over on the purple
red mic. Red mic.
Going back to what the discussion has been, what if Adam and Eve passed the test and they didn't sin? Well, I recall that God had direct communication with them before they sinned, actually after they sinned as well.
Yep.
So I picture if they had passed the test, that God would continue to dwell in person with his people on earth. That's a picture.
And that, from what we see in Revelation, that seems perfectly reasonable.
And let's look at it this way. How does God communicate to humanity? How has he communicated from what the Bible reveals over time? What are some of the ways in which God has communicated to people?
Visions,
dreams.
And when he came down and spoken directly to them.
He comes down and speaks directly. He sends angels. Sometimes it seems like when they caught up in the vision, the prophet literally sees themselves being taken to other places. Brad's question, would they have been stuck on the earth? Maybe not. Or maybe God has different ways of transporting us and leaving us at the same time. You know, we think of time and space. God doesn't have those issues. The timeless one does not have issues about time, and the omnipresent one doesn't have issues about space.
So, as we're talking about creation and created, how were we created differently than the rest of creation? You sort of talked about it a little bit before.
We hinted at it. What does God do there? What does the passage say in chapter 2?
So if we start even before that, if we go back to Genesis 1:3, it says God created the heavens and the earth. He said, let there be light. He said, let there be fish, water. Let there be animals teeming the oceans. Let. He calls things into existence.
Mm-hmm.
And then with Adam, like you're saying in chapter 2, we get to verse 7. Then the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And as we talked about before, that's very intimate. He is face to face.
So we have the idea of God's, just this power and grandeur, omnipotence, but then we also have the idea of God very close and personal. He's not a God just kind of way out there. He's a God that uses. Now, I'm going to throw, not a red herring, but I'm going to throw a different look at this. If I'm reading the correct exegesis of Revelation chapter 13, which is actually the dragon story, the serpent story, it's the serpent working through beasts and his witnesses in Revelation 13. It makes a side comment that there's a book of life whose names are written in the book of life from the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. A lot of translations list the book of life was written in the foundation of the world, but no, the Greek actually is saying it was the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. So before the foundation of the world, we have a Lamb that already stands slain. So if God is creating through Jesus, and he is called in the Gospel of John the Lamb of God, and the Word of God, by the way, think about on this weekend when people think of the Good Friday yesterday and the resurrection tomorrow. Think of the type of hands. Was the stigmata, the holes, from God's perspective, in a certain sense, already there. And I'm saying this kind of metaphorically or not allegorically, but metaphorically, God already is building in the concept of redemption.
Yes.
Because it's the blood, his life-giving blood and his life-giving breath, which holds everything together and gives life. So it's just a thought. Yeah. Anyway.
And we can't forget Eve. We cannot forget Eve.
No.
Because he was just as intimately involved in her creation as in Adam's creation.
Yeah, it takes both.
Formed.
Chapter 1 says it's male and female in relationship with God that reflects the image of God. You can't have one without the other.
Right, and they were both intimately formed. God formed them both.
And I think God educated them both.
Hmm.
We're slightly different on that, but
so,
I don't think Adam had to tell Eve what to do, I think, from the very beginning. I think God told Eve directly. But that's just me.
I don't understand.
Well, I thought you referred in your lesson where Adam taught Eve.
Oh, yeah, we're not there yet. Okay, I'm coming back up to you. Okay.
I'm jumping ahead and just saying,
we're about to go there.
I beg to differ a little bit, but that's okay. It's not an altar to die on.
Why did God put the tree in the garden? Was it a trap?
No, that's a great way of phrasing it, though, because that's how most people see it.
What was that? It was obedience. It was not a trap.
Well,
without it, in fact, if we go to Job, right, if we go to Job chapter 1, we see the reason why there was a tree, believe it or not. Because, and for some reason I can't get past Kings. Here we go. Ezra, Job. There we go.
Okay.
So in Job 1, we see that Satan tells God, does Job love you for nothing? You've put a hedge around him. You protect him. There's no reason for him to not choose you. Well, now you're going to ask
five
me. Just
or
sort
six?
Of, sort of going.
Job
where did
1,
you come from? Job 1, 8. Have you considered?
Yeah.
Have
nine.
You considered your servant Job? There is none like him. He is blameless and upright. Then Satan says, does he fear God for nothing? Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? He has no reason to not love you.
Mm-hmm. My question, I'm going to throw this into there. Is the tree, I'm going to go back to your initial picture of God as teacher.
Yeah.
Is the tree about obedience, or is the tree teaching? Is the tree about restraint, or is the tree about freedom? And what kind of God? What is one thing that is a fundamental characteristic of love?
Freedom.
Freedom, or we call choice.
Choice.
Now, think of the choice of how God presented the choice. We get hung up real quickly on verse 17.
Yep.
We need to read very carefully verse 16. Because you can't read this passage in verses 15, 16, and 17 apart from chapter 3, verse 1.
Yep.
But let's look at chapter, verse 15 says, the Lord took man and put him in the garden. By the way, we need to go to that one because that one actually related to the word subdued that you wanted to talk about. You have to harmonize subdued with cultivate and keep. Subdued there isn't, it has the idea of violence like you suggested. But the point here is that the Lord took man and put him in the Garden of Eden. The Lord commanded him saying, from any tree in the garden you may freely eat. There's 3,000 trees and 2,999 of them are for you. And there's one.
For me.
There's one that you need to not eat from. And that is a choice you will make. God is teaching the idea of choice because love has choice and freedom has limits or restraints. And when you look at it in those terms, you take it a little bit more out of the legal realm and you're teaching what love is and how love works. Love works with my willingness to yield to the other and put a restraint on just what I want to do. I will ascend to heaven. I will say, no. Love has restraints. It respects the other because love always involves more than one. And so the tree was the one place where we learn about the idea of choice and the idea of restraint. Not a burden. God's commandments are not, the Bible says, burdensome.
Yeah.
This wasn't an overburdening command. And God is not saying, if you eat it, I'll kill you.
No.
Does he say that? He's saying, if you eat this, I'm going to kill you.
No, he says, if you eat it, you will die.
You will die. You will separate. You will, if you go unrestrained without me, I can't help you.
Tina.
Red mic.
You took some of the words out of my mouth, but
sorry.
That's okay. God was trying to establish a relationship with Adam and Eve built on love. And love, it develops trust. And so in that relationship, they should have known that God had their best interest in mind. And for some reason, and of course we do the same things, we get distracted or deceived in some way, and Eve was deceived into thinking that the serpent was offering something better than what they already had.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems that, well, part of the reason Eve got distracted is because she wandered away from Adam. That's part of the story. But in essence, she was distracted so that her trust in God was interrupted. And even though Adam, as the Spirit of Prophecy points out, Adam was not deceived. He knew what Eve had done. And it grieved his heart, and he was so torn with what the consequences would be for her that his love, he decided his love for her was greater than his love for God.
Which means he was deceived.
Yes, that's true.
Because in the New Testament, it blames Adam and not Eve. Here's another point. What the tree taught, not only is it proper, it's the restraint of freedom. This is what we're getting back to covenant now. The restraint of freedom, plus the consent of lovers, choice of will needs to be exercised. And the tree brings in these three realities of restraint, consent, and choice, where the actual presence of the tree is for provision and protection more than it is for punishment or threat. The tree becomes a the tree is necessary in Eden because evil is already present in a world that God made very good. There was one thing that is not very good, and that is the presence of evil, the presence of darkness, which is already there before we get into the story. The devil bursts on the story in chapter 3, but this is one of the God has to put that in because of the presence of evil and what will be allowed to happen, because love doesn't force the universe. See, we have to take our eyes off of the world. God has a greater universe to consider what we see. At morning, stars are singing together and they're watching too, as we read Job earlier.
Yeah.
So just some more thoughts on this idea, but go ahead.
Back to the lesson. So the question I have, based on what Tina was talking about, what you've been talking about, so Eve eats the fruit. Now Adam is sitting there, and he's got a choice of what to do.
Trust
it
God?
It seems so, but really, right? Trust God? What does that mean? What does that do in that situation? Does he take Eve to God and say,
"What can we do?"
Say, "What can we do?" Does he attack the serpent? Does he? What does
she wants to come to the mic? Do? She wants to tell us what God's going to do.
I can't wait.
What she thinks God's going to do.
Yes. So with this idea of choice, we do in the idea of love and freedom. But if we look at existence in a way, we don't choose to be in this world. We were, you know, when we were born, we didn't choose to exist.
Correct.
So it kind of brings us back to the fact that it's all God's doing. I feel like God has a plan to begin with way before existence, you know.
We have the reality, which makes me wonder, we don't know how it would come into play. What if Adam at that point had said, "What have you done? What can we do?" What if he takes that problem to God? But he doesn't. But what if? We're playing hypotheticals, and so somewhere he has to make a choice now.
Yes.
He's forced to make a choice. She was deceived and made a choice, and now he's forced to make a choice.
And his choice was to blame God for his problems. Look at the woman you gave me.
Yeah, well, that's eventually what happens after his eyes are opened too. And she blames the snake. But God, by the way, does put, what's interesting, God puts in chapter 3 the blame on the snake. Because he's the first one God addresses. The snake, he turns to the snake and basically saying, she's right. You're the reason.
You are the deceiver.
But God has a plan that is still going forward, because there is this lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world.
Which is going
and
to
I'm wondering how that would have, I'm just speculating how that might have come into play had Adam at that moment chosen to talk to God about his problem.
Yeah.
I have a sneaking suspicion God had a solution that would have been satisfactory for both Adam and both Eve, because God is love. I think that when, look at it this way. Let's just use the logic of the New Testament in a relationship with Jesus, okay? Peter, what does he do? He denies his Lord, etc. Does Jesus give Peter a second chance?
Yes.
So we could say that God of the universe is a God of second, third, and 30th chances, or set 490th chances if your brother sins against you 70 times. 70 times 7. So, do you suppose that that kind of God, before the creation, when he was in angelic realms, was a God of second chances for angelic beings who were in the throes of a controversy in heaven? Is he a God that would have been a God of second chances for a woman who was deceived into eating fruit? It makes to me a consistent sense of love and what love does. God is a God of second chances. And does he give that first fallen pair a second chance?
Yes.
So
we have to be done now, unfortunately. We didn't get to talk about subdued. I'm very disappointed.
I'm sorry.
We'll talk about it some other time.
We subdued the subdue.
would you close it with prayer?
Sure. Father in heaven, we are grateful that you are a God who has amazing power revealed in self-giving love. A love that will stoop low and shape and breathe. A love that will come in person and die and bleed. We want to pray, Father, that we will learn about love. We'll let you educate us, and that we will let you recreate us into beings of that you intended from us to be from the very beginning. We want to thank you for keeping your promises. We thank you for the faithfulness of Jesus. In his name we praise you. Amen. Thank you. Good morning. Good morning.
Well, happy Sabbath, Pastor.
Yeah, there we go.
Yes.
We'll be.
There you go.
We got to be that far away. Come this way. I'm stepping this way.
Okay,
kind of. There we go. There we go. We're both here.
We'd like to welcome all of you.
Yeah, there we go.
Sabbath morning.
Yeah, welcome. It's the Sabbath of Easter weekend. This is one of the more populated days of worship around the country on Sabbath and Sunday. And we invite you and welcome you, those who are watching online and those who are present. Our numbers are increasing a little bit, so it's good. We have several announcements we want to make. What's our first one here?
Every day I pass the road, I see the sign about the enrollment for our Kitsap Adventist Christian School. So we can help out on that process by praying that many would take a walk and try to experience our school and like, and then maybe many more kids will join us.
We're hoping to go to that fourth teacher this year and pray for that process. If you have any information on the board there in your bulletin to call, if you are so inclined or desire to send your kids or know someone that needs to send their kids to school. Mm. We also have children's ministry after church today. Darlene is teaching children's ministry workshop over in the, for parents, for Sabbath school teaching, for all that, and ministry to kids, and it'll be over in the multi-purpose room right after church today, and people have already been notified and signed up, so hope you can attend and gain a few tidbits to not only be a better teacher, but a better parent even. A lot of the stuff transfers over, you know. What else we got? Just another one more.
Yep, of course, the April 12th, 6:30 in person. You can at the church board is scheduled.
That's so a week from Monday.
Participate and join.
And a Zoom link, too, to make that happen. I don't have any other announcements. Do you have any?
Oh, other than like to recognize the presence of the little ones in our church. It's so good to see all of them.
Yeah, good to see everyone here. Why don't you, we'll have,
okay.
Why don't you go pretty soon and call us to worship here this morning.
For our call to worship, we'd like to invite the congregation to stand with me as I do my reading for this morning, for a call to worship. And while we're doing that, before I read, I'd like to welcome the our singers to come up front before we pray. Our scripture that I would like to read today is from the book of Psalms 119, verses 30 to 40. It reads, "Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep them, keep it to the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep your law. Indeed, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Make me walk in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to covetousness. Turn away my eyes from looking at the worthless things and revive me in your ways. Establish your words to your servants who is devoted to fearing you. Turn away my reproach, which I dread, for your judgments are good. Behold, I long for your precepts. Revive me in your righteousness." Shall we pray? Father in heaven, as we have gathered this morning, we invite thee, Lord, to be in our midst, to be very spirit close to us, that we may feel you and sense your presence, and accept our acts of worship in songs, in prayers, and in meditations, in our deepest thoughts, in our hearts, that the Holy Spirit will translate them into the language that God will speak to God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. me near the cross. There a precious mountain, free to all a healing sweet, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the
seated.
It's now time for our tithes and offering and worship and giving. God is so good to us that he gives us an opportunity and ability to earn a living. And now that I am retired, it seems like the Lord is so good. I don't have to worry about finances. All we need to do is trust in him. So this week, our offering is for our local church ministries. It includes all the expenses we have for buying materials for Sabbath school, our electricity, and for all the blessings that we do enjoy. And God is so good that he's protecting our building, and we're comfortable inside. So remember the children across the street. They're part of our ministry. They're a big part of our ministry. That they need us, that we need them, because they're our future. So remember them when you do your tithes and offer in your giving. So we have the baskets outside, and then so there's a basket for the school offering, and there's another receptacle for the tithes that you put in your envelope. So we pray. Father in heaven, you have blessed us with so much. We'd like to return to you what is due to you, and like to add our little offering that we can help out to defray the expenses of our church and also to keep our school in smooth operation. So bless us, Lord, and again, we just want to give you thanks, for thou hast been so generous, and may we be the same, to be generous when time comes. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's time now for a children's story, and I'm going to tell a story this morning. The kids can stay where they are right now. I just want to actually show you one slide on the screen. I think I have it there. Oh, I do not. I do have it here. There we go. It'll come up again. You're going to hear a story today when my son Brad is speaking to you. It's going to be a story about a guy who didn't want to go to Nineveh, and he wanted to go to Tarshish. And Tarshish, if we look at that map compared to where he was, I don't think was on the way. In fact, it was going the other way, and we know Jonah as a runaway. I don't know if you've ever run away, but I've run away a couple times as a kid. I never really lasted long. I was so mad at my mom and dad, and I was so mad at my brothers and sisters that I grabbed a small bag of food, and I went off, and I went to go and hide in a area not too far from our house. Across the railroad tracks and down, there was a limestone connection for heavy rains to let water go through, and during the dry season, you could hide in there. And usually, once you got knocked all in the spiders and cobwebs, it was kind of dry and a place just to sort of be, and I ran away. But then after a while, when my food was gone, my stomach got hungry, and I didn't stay gone real long. But then when I got older, I learned how to be running away more sophisticatedly. Because when I was really mad at God about things that weren't going right in my life, I decided, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to go to the Peace Corps. I'm just going to run away. I'm going to go as far away as I can. And I went all the way to a place called Nepal, which is not on the map here. But it was as far away almost in the world as you could get in the Northern Hemisphere from where I lived in Eau Claire, Wisconsin. I went all the way to Nepal, which I was actually really close to Mount Everest, the biggest mountain in the world. I've seen it personally. I was near Mount Everest when I actually, that's where God, that was the whale. I didn't get swallowed up by a whale. I got swallowed up by a mountain. It was, and I was going, wow. And there were so many things that made me think about God when I was running away from God that I ended up giving my heart to God when I was there in the foot of the mountain. Today, I want you to listen real closely, because in a while, that guy's going to get up there and he's going to tell you about another guy that ran away. And he's going to tell him that you might even like to hear it again. So, just wanting to let you know that wherever you go, God says you can run away to the heights, to the depths, to the farthest directions. And God says, I am there. And I'll meet you there when you decide to stop and listen. So, that's my brief story today, because I want to allow enough time for the other stories that will be coming. Let's continue on with our scripture reading.
Happy Sabbath to each and every member. The Sabbath day. Scripture is found in Matthew 12:39-40. But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given it but the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. May God bless the reading of his word.
I think, yeah, okay. I'm used to tapping on these things to make sure they're on. Habits die hard. Heavenly Father, bless us this morning as we open your word. Thank you for being here. Appreciate this. In Jesus' name, amen. As a time of rebirth and new life, Easter arrives to us very neatly packaged, very comfortably typecast. We know the story. We know it quite well. We know all the players. Were we to round them up, the usual Easter suspects would be prohibitively first and foremost the Easter Bunny, followed closely by, actually, I don't know which would come first, the chicken or the egg. But surely, either would be welcome at our display, along with Christ, which would be very bright and very cheery and painted in vibrant pastel colors. And yet, I may have already spoiled with the scripture reading, Jesus, the prohibitive king of the unexpected, would heave out of the seething darkest depths of the sea to land splat in the middle of our pastel display, of all things, a whale. How is the whale for your Easter animal? We turn to the book of Luke, chapter 11, verse 29. As the crowds increased, Jesus said, "This is a wicked generation. It asks for a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah." Some context for these words. We're already well into the Gospel of Luke. Jesus works his miracles all the time, healing the sick, casting out demons, and yet loving and life-giving demonstrations of the love of God for his people do not move the needle of faith for a select few. A generation of skeptics who cannot be satisfied by mere love, but seem to be asking for Jesus to do something which is absolutely impossible. Okay, the casting out demons. Okay, the healing of the sick. Okay, changing lives for the better. Who cares? Do something impossible. Give us a magic trick. Well, to find the impossible, which Jesus refers to here, we go to the book of Jonah. We'll read the whole thing. Don't worry, it's a short book. We'll start in chapter 1. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship and lain down and was fast asleep. So the captain came to him and said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish." And they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us." And so they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation, and where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you?" So he said to them, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, "Why have you done this?" For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then they said to him, "What shall we do with you, that the sea may be calm for us?" For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will become calm for you. For I know that this great tempest is because of me." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous around them. Therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, "We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Establishing character for our prophet of God, Jonah, we find that he is a very interesting prophet of God, in that first, he is a conscript. He did not ask to go. He was selected. And second of all, Jonah is a draft dodger. Given a mission from God to go to people who, unlike others that have not done anything to Jonah, they haven't done anything for Jonah. "Hell no, I won't go. Hell no, I won't go," is what Jonah says. Jonah immediately gets on the boat and runs not to Canada, but to, I believe, Joppa. Hold on, let me get this right. Tarsus. Yeah, from Joppa to Tarsus, that's why. Anyways, leaves. It's interesting, as the French philosopher René Girard has pointed out, that the most necessary thing for most humans to do in a crisis which befalls the group is to establish blame. Not solve the problem, it's just good to know who's responsible for the problem. And this story is very on the nose for that entire process, from the drawing of lots to the expulsion of the scapegoat to the peace that enters the situation the moment that the offending party is dealt with. For me, however, one of the coolest parts of the story is that even after having identified the offending party from among their number, the crew of this boat, with, as we have established, no prior relationship with the God of Israel, work for Jonah's salvation. To save someone, they understand to have incurred the wrath of the gods. They start rowing as fast as they can. They don't throw him overboard, they throw the cargo overboard. They start rowing as fast as they can to land rather than do the natural thing and yeet him over the side. It's somehow ironic that they extend grace to someone who is literally running away from a mission to extend grace. Without knowing God, they follow God. And a theme we'll double down on later, but I will bring up now, is if you don't immediately know what God is doing in a given situation, and you've been given the option between putting your money on divine retribution or on grace, bet on grace. Bet on grace. That's what God is likely doing. Grace, amazing grace in the case of Jonah, arrives in the form of a whale. Perhaps the unlikeliest among the service animals of God, certainly less common than donkeys and ravens. But that was kind of the point, wasn't it? You asked for a sign, you asked for the impossible. Well, here's something aggressively and blatantly impossible. Will that change your heart? We read Jonah 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God, from the fish's belly, and he said, "I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice, for you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The waters surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains, the earth with its bars closed behind me forever, yet you have brought up my life from the pit, O Lord. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy, but I will sacrifice to you. with the voice of thanksgiving, I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is from the Lord. So the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto the dry land. So not only is Jonah swallowed, we're here in the realm of the impossible, not only is Jonah swallowed, but he is conscious through the whole ordeal and aware of being hurled into the depths. He's scared of his life ebbing away. This is the sign that Jesus is referring to, the depths, the place where only the hand of God can preserve and save, and Jonah goes there. Jonah goes into the realm of the dead, and he marinates. For 3 days, wearing a seaweed wrap in a krill spa, Jonah is processing, and then slowly notices that he's not being processed, but rather saved. He gives thanks to God for his salvation and begins to make promises to God, to praise him and sacrifice to him. And after 3 days and three nights, the whale has arrived at its destination. It's interesting to note here that no mention of God's mission and no mention of Nineveh ever escapes Jonah's lips while he's in the belly of the whale. We are truly looking at a prophet who is not in a prophetic mindset at this point. God, yes. God's temple, yes. God's glory, yes. God's people? Nope. Not the best prophet. Now we read Jonah 3. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, because it needed to be said a second time, by the way, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, a 3-day journey in extent, and Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. And then he cried out and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. That's the sermon. Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. The word came to the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne and laid aside his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes, and he caused it to be proclaimed and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil ways and from the violence that is in his hands. Who can tell if God will return and relent and turn away from his fierce anger so we may not perish? And then the Lord saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God relented from the disaster that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. God works, it's been said, in mysterious ways. This story already feels strange for a couple of reasons. Well, for several, actually. But mainly because of how poorly it fits the John 3:16 standard model of salvation as a process. If I were to try to overlay the one with the other, it might sound like this. For God so loved Nineveh that he sent a storm and a whale to collect the wayward prophet that he had conscripted, so that having arrived in Nineveh with his wild ravings about whales, only validated by the smell of his clothing and the seaweed in his hair, he could preach a gloom and doom sermon about the destruction of their city, probably unable to conceal the glee in his voice at the thought of them being killed by fire and brimstone, so that the whole city might believe in him and not perish and have everlasting life. Amen. Circuitous to say the least, very, very indirect, very, very unorthodox. To continue Jesus' conversation with the skeptics, we turn back to Luke chapter 11, verse 30. For as Jonah was assigned to the Ninevites, so also will the Son of Man be to this generation. The Queen of the South will rise at the judgment with the people for this generation and condemn them, for she came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon's wisdom, and now something greater than Solomon is here. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and now something greater than Jonah is here. Indeed, it would be hard not to be more pastoral than Jonah. In fact, wishing for something other than the complete destruction of the people in your evangelistic series puts you ahead of him by a mile. We come to Jonah at the end of a miracle, one he participated in, one for the books. In fact, one that is even recorded in this book. But do we see in Jonah a changed man? A better prophet? Someone who realizes the importance and glory of what he's helped to bring about? The agency of God? Do we see that? Nope. In fact, we read in chapter 4 these bizarre words. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly. And he became angry, so he prayed to the Lord and said, Ah, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore, I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness and soft on crime. Sorry, white. One who relents from doing harm. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Then the Lord said, Is it right for you to be angry? So Jonah went out from the city and sat on the east side of the city. There he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade till he might see what would become of the city. Please, God, brimstone. Just nuke them till they glow and shoot them in the dark. And the Lord God prepared a plant and made it come up over Jonah that it might be shade for his head to deliver him from his misery. So Jonah was very grateful for the plant. But as morning dawned the next day, God prepared a worm, and it so damaged the plant that it withered. And as it happened, when the sun arose, that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. Then he wished death for himself and said, It is better for me to die than to live. Then God said to Jonah, Is it right for you to be angry about the plant? And he said, It is right for me to be angry, even to death. But the Lord said, You have had pity on the plant for which you have not labored, nor made it grow, which came up in a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city in which are more than 120,000 persons who cannot discern between their right hand and their left, and their livestock? There are three things we see in the backdrop of Jonah that obtain new significance with Jesus in the equation. One, that there are no lengths nor depths to which God will not go in order to save his people. Period. Two, that there is nothing so miraculous we can experience that can literally force a heart change in us if we are unwilling. And three, that there is no end to God's patience with the unwilling, that he will cease to try to accomplish his mission. Jonah was mad. He knew who God was. He didn't want to go because he knew who God was. He was angry because he knew that God was soft on crime and long on love. Jonah recognizes the saving character of God, and it makes him angry. He's got a really bad case of older brother syndrome when faced with the prodigal son right there. He sees the character of God truly as it will later be uncovered and revealed in the character of Christ. Unlike Jonah, there are no lengths nor depths to which God will not go to save. Jesus did not have to be drafted. He did not dodge. He volunteered to come here. Not for the select and the elect, but for everyone. God does not save at the cute and pastel level. God saves at the giant marine mammal level. He's unstinting with the miraculous, if that is what it takes to save the people he loves. Because the hell of it is, and yes, I do mean the word hell, that not even miracles matter in any number to the skeptics in front of Jesus in Luke. Signs and wonders are not what change hearts in the Bible, only love. When the people were standing in front of Jesus saying, enough with the little stuff. Enough with the little stuff, like casting out demons and healing the sick. Enough with the little stuff that brings new life. Give us a big one. Give us a magic trick. They are misunderstanding the person in front of them and what his job is, because resurrection, spiritual and physical, is the work and character of God. Specifically, unlike Jonah, God is not willing that any should perish. Specifically, unlike Jonah, God does not turn his back on the wicked. And where Jonah is wicked, God does not even turn his back on him. Instead, Jesus comes to this world unfairly, is singled out unfairly throughout his life, selected for abuse and mockery, does nothing but love, and gets nothing but killed unfairly. At the edge of Nineveh, confronted with the possibility of salvation for the city, Jonah, in almost direct quotation of the Antichrist, says, I would rather die than see these people saved. And at the foundation of the world, drawing up invasion plans, confronted with the possibility of death for any one of us, any one of us, Jesus Christ volunteered because he would rather die than see any one of us lost. He would rather die for Nineveh and for Jonah and for us, so that we are not left in the abyss of existence without him, but are brought forth into new life together with him. Together with God is our destiny, and so we have to get used to it. Was it harder for Nineveh, who, upon reflection, realized the consequences of their violence, or for Jonah, who, after seaweed wrap treatment and then a self-inflicted tanning bed of suffering, because he couldn't bear to be with the people he had helped to save, was still complaining to God at the end of his own book about God's grace having been extended to the undeserving? But God was not done with Jonah. God, whose grace Jonah complained about, extends his grace to Jonah as well in the final miracle that this book was written at all. Apparently, somewhere between the end of the book, where he's still angry at God, and the time that we're reading it here today, God's long game with Jonah pays off stage. Jonah realizes what's going on and chronicles the whole miraculous mess exactly as he's experienced it. He isn't the hero of his own story. God is, and he knows it. Eventually, and it takes a while, all of the miracles Jonah has experienced, borne witness to, and even participated in, come crashing down in a wave of understanding of God's grace, and he realizes, like so many of us, so much of the time, oh, so I was the jerk the whole time. Thank you, God, for putting up with me. Heavenly Father, today I want to thank you so much for your amazing grace. I want to thank you for your patience with who I am. I want to thank you for extending resurrection over and over to all of us, unstintingly, miraculously, in aquatic mammal proportions. I want to thank you so much for that huge love that you have. And I'm just asking that we would carry that with us into this coming year, that we would remember who you are and give thanks to you for your character and for your love. I thank you and praise you in Jesus' name, amen.
I'd like to invite the congregation to kneel with me in prayer. Our loving Father in heaven, we are truly, truly grateful because we have heard your voice, we have heard your invitation, that you're so patient with us, that this season of the whole earth, all the ones that are thinking of this resurrection weekend, we join them and in a very special way that we lift our hearts up towards heaven and thinking about our Savior who came down to save us all and gave us the promise that when he comes, he will save those who have believed in him and also that gave us a mission to tell others that there's hope, that there is salvation, that still available, if only they believe. So, Father, thank you. And thank you again for the miracle that many of our brothers and sisters have experienced this week in terms of healing and strengthening, and most of all, the continuous hope that you in the clouds of heaven will come and welcome your people. So, Father in heaven, so we just want to give you thanks because we are in awe, because we are in the presence of our God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Can you switch the songs? I'm sorry. He knows my name. Can you flip them around? Thank you.
I have a maker. He formed before even time began, my life was in his hands. He knows my name. He knows my every thought.
He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call. I have a Father, He calls me His own. He'll never leave me, no matter where I go. He knows my name.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on His hands. Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see Him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on Him and pardon me. To look on Him and pardon me. Behold Him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness. The great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with Himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by His blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my
Savior and my God. Shall we all stand, please? Our Father in heaven, we pray for blessings from the people who have attended today, from the youngest to the oldest. that the coming week will be in us, be full of victories, and I trust that you will get us through all the struggles and the tests that we'll go through. So, Father in heaven, may we live according to the life that our Lord Savior led, and may the Holy Spirit give us the energy to do well and to be generous to one another. And thank you again for blessing us with your presence. In Jesus' holy name, amen.